We're very pleased to have here, visiting at Duke University, President Turgut Özal of the Republic of Turkey. Welcome.
Thank you.
Our interview with him is on the Living History Program, and it's made possible by support from the William R. Keenan Jr. Charitable Trust. My name is Bruce Cunningham. I'm a professor of public policy and history at Duke University. On my left is Bülent Gültekin. He's a professor of finance at the Wharton School at the University of Pennsylvania. And on my right is Professor Ole Holste, a professor of political science at Duke University. President Özal, in light of President Bush's glowing praise of your role in the recent Gulf crisis, could you tell us something about your relationship with him, the number and frequency and length of your conversations, the nature of your discussions? Were they one-on-one? Did you have your advisors with you? Did you do substantial preparations before them? Could you give us some insight into that relationship?
I know President Bush before, when he was vice president to President Reagan. But our relation improved after he became president, and especially after this Gulf crisis, second. And probably we have made maybe 17, 18, or maybe 20 telephone calls to speak about what's going on in the area, what has to be done, what cannot be done, what we can have. And during this period, I think we discussed quite a lot what's going on in the area, what's the intention of President Saddam Hussein, what would be the intention, and what way we can take care of it. Certainly, in the meantime, I would discuss with my advisors, close advisor, I should say, people in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, or we have a different system of than yours, Minister of Foreign Affairs, or Chief of Staff, or let me say, Prime Minister, which we have. And during these discussions, also there has been frequent visit of different his secretaries, such as Secretary Cheney, Secretary Baker, and once in a while I talk with the Ambassador of United States. And I think all went very well, because what we have estimated at the beginning, it was very close, what we found out at the end.
President Özal, as you reflect on the difficult problems you've had running your own government, what are the problems that you've encountered that you find most difficult? And for those of us who educate students to play a role in government, are there things that we can educate them to do so that they can be prepared to deal with these difficulties, or is it something you have to learn on the job?
I think it's got to be learned during the job. But I can tell you what are the main difficulties, or what are the main problems an administrator will face, or a prime minister will face. Turkey is a developing country, and it has to take a lot of new reforms, change. Normally, people would like to have statu quo, continuity. And they are against the change. I think in every society, not only belongs to Turkey, but also other societies. Now, in a democratic society, it is very difficult to achieve these major changes. Now, your society, it's an evolving, but taking the step by step, smaller steps, the change occurs, very smaller steps. But in our society, it has to be with jumps, because there are very big difference. A developed country and a developing country. And difficulty, I found out, we have a very large increase of population compared to other developed countries. Now, in 1980, we had a population of about 42, 43 million. Today, we have 57 million. Now, if we have not made the change in 10 years, made basic economic changes, I should say, then we will not be able to overcome the difficulties with this population. And therefore, maybe change occurred in your case in a period of 50 years, but it has to be squeezed in a period of 10 years in my country. Now, that is against the human nature in most of the case. And to tell the people that you have to do it, or you have to, and there is no other alternative, it's very difficult sometimes to convince them.
You mentioned in your discussion that the rather rapid pace of population growth in your country, as you look forward for the next decade, the next two decades, do you see a role in population control for attempting to bridge the gap that you say has to be between development and underdevelopment?
Usually what happens, I think I look the many experience of the other countries such as India and China. China has a different rule. I mean, that was a communist rule, and you may have some effective control, whatever it is. But in a democratic society, it's difficult. The Indian experience is not very successful. I found out in my country, with the cultural development, urbanization, and living standard increases, the population growth will come down. And this is our experience. Once we had 3.6% increase during 1950s, but today it is under 2.2%. Probably at the end of this century, it will be under 2%. Then Western Anatolia, which is much more developed compared to Eastern Anatolia, probably we have lower percentage. And the increase in the Western Anatolia is coming mainly from the immigration from Eastern Anatolia. And therefore I say, yes, we have what we call a family planning. Not exactly, but it's not compulsory. It is, we are trying to help the people. I mean, give necessary methods, education and so. But I see it with the electrification, television, and many new things coming up, the population increase will decrease.
Mr. President, I was curious to hear your views about managing a changing society. And the reason for that, I know you and I work with you, but I would like you to sort of tell us a little how you started in 1979, because you were not a trained or practiced politician.
No, that's true.
And if you take us from 1979 on, what Turkey was, what sort of situation it was, and what you were trying to do, maybe you can give some examples as to how it is difficult to change a society within the machinery even.
Although I am not related to direct politics, I have involved in the political activity during as early as 1960, when the military coup in 1960 occurred. I was in favor of the previous party, Democrat Party, which was the prime minister was Menderes, who was hanged. I am very sorry that who was hanged. And during that period, we worked to support the new formation of the parties. I was very close friend of the Prime Minister Demirel, who took over after 1965, or during 1965, became Prime Minister of Turkey. I was very close friend to him. But I prefer stay out of politics, and I went into to public works, I should say government jobs. I became, step by step coming up, I became head of Turkish Plan Organization during 67 to 71. And I learned quite a lot during that period. 71, there was another army intervention. Prime Minister Demirel were ousted, and I resigned 1 month later and came to United States. I became advisor in the World Bank for a period of 2.5 years. That also added some of my knowledge already existed in Turkey. And also I happened to know different parts of the world. In 1973, I returned to Turkey. And I went into the private business. Many different companies, I mean, chairman, vice chairman, general manager. I played this different role. And also I had been a labor relations activities with the business groups. I headed one of the big business group relating to labor relations, the metal working group. In 1979, there was a change in the government. Prime Minister Demirel came back to power, and he called me. Turkey was in a great difficulty during 1977 to 79. Anarchy in one side, political anarchy inside Turkey. There was terrorism, act of terrorism, and people killed on the streets, left, right, extremists. In addition to that, there was an anarchy on the economy. There was big shortage of foreign exchange, shortage of everything almost. I mean, like the Soviet Union, what we have today, big coups. And there was no hope almost. How we are going to get rid of all those difficulties? During these years, I mean, before coming to the administration, I had involved in many activities, what way we can have change in Turkey. Even I wrote some articles about it. Made some conferences, speeches in different societies. When Mr. Demirel called me and he offered me to become his governor of Central Bank, I said, no, I cannot do with the, this job with the, as a governor of Central Bank, because Central Bank was an organization of the Treasury, tied to Treasury. It was not an independent organization like you have or some German Bundesbank. And I said, I would try to help you if you give me the possibility of being the top bureaucrat, which is the undersecretary of the prime minister, and also acting undersecretary of the planning organization, which was my old job with Prime Minister Demirel in 1960s. He accepted. I also headed the Money and Credit Policy Committee and Economic Coordination Committee. That was formed by the all top bureaucrats. But the Turkish condition was very difficult at that time. I say there was shortage of everything. I remember I worked in the Prime Ministry at the winter time with overcoats because we didn't have fuel oil, even in the Prime Ministry. The road transport almost stopped because lack of diesel fuel. I prepared a program, discussed with the IMF to get some help, and finalized that program. In the meantime, there was what I call it an letter from the chief of staff to the president of Turkey. And the prime minister was very much doubtful about the outcome. He couldn't decide on the program. And I told him, either you have to take those people from their job his chief of staff and his commanders, or let me go to explain them what is the Turkish situation. And I went there. I explained the whole difficult situation Turkey faced in those days. It was about a three-hour discussion in the chief of staff and all army commanders, navy and air force, top generals. And I think I was able to convince them the Turkey going into a very difficult period. Then on 24th of January, we first announced the whole new program. It was a complete change, almost I should say 180 degree different policy than what they followed before. Freeing all prices, there was control of prices, like you had once in the Nixon administration time, price and wage control, I remember. And complete elimination of the price controls, an increase of prices of state economic enterprise, maybe 3 times, 5 times. There was unrealistic prices, such as now they have in Eastern Bloc countries. I can tell you the budget was 100, Turkish budget. The price increases caused 60% of the budget revenue, almost. That was a very big amount of price increases. The first month we had a 29% increase in the prices, inflation. But afterwards, because the normal economic system played its role, the shelves become more with the different products, and the shortage eliminated in the coming few months. We have rescheduled our debt through the Paris Club, and increased aid from the World Bank and also IMF. I think Turkey went through, in about 10 months, everything started to become online. But terrorism continued, anarchy continued. And finally, army intervened in 12 September. Contrary to the intervention in 1971, which I was undersecretary in planning with Prime Minister Demirel, this time also Prime Minister was Demirel, and they said this time, you should not go out, you should work with us. I worked with them in the military government as Deputy Prime Minister in charge of economy again.
But how did they make you Deputy Prime Minister? Because you were a bureaucrat, that's quite a big jump.
It's quite difficult. Sometimes I found out army and armed forces are much more conservative than politicians. They found a prime minister, which was an old politician. And they asked him what job I should take it. He proposed me in front of the two general, which was the one of the leader, later became the president, seventh president of Turkey. And he proposed me the Minister of State in charge of outside affairs, economic affairs of Turkey. I said no, because my job is not looking for relation with World Bank or IMF only, but I am taking care of the inside economic affairs of Turkey. And therefore I should become Deputy Prime Minister, and I should also control Minister of Finance and Minister of Trade. If you can give these things, I can work with you. Otherwise, I won't. It is very interesting. The Prime Minister objected that this is against the Constitution. I said, but we talk about the Constitution. There are generals, they can change the Constitution right away, with just one word, because there was no Constitution after the coup. And later they accepted I had one of my friends became the Minister of Finance, actually under control, tied to me. And I worked with the military government 22 months. 22 months, I think many things is corrected. Anarchy was come down very rapidly. They had the full control. And they decided to return to democracy. But in the meantime, at the mid of 1982, 22 months later, there was some problem with the street bankers. I had made the interest rate free, not controlled by the governments, and banks, they can establish their interest rate, deposit rates freely. And then there were bankers, what I call it. And they started to come into picture. There are some miss of regulation. and one of the big bankers collapsed. And the generals put the charge on the Minister of Finance, which was my man. I said, if you take him, I will go. And I resigned. And roughly 7 months later, they permitted to form new parties in order to pass democracy. I formed Motherland Party.
Where did the idea for ANAP come from?
I think I say one thing. Maybe I'll give that document to you later on through Blend. In 1979, I wrote an article. Mainly, what is the new development policy of Turkey? And in this document, I wrote what we have to do. And when you look today, what is done in Turkey in the last 8-9 years, it is probably 80% is given in that document, which was in written in 1979. The idea basically came from the people. I mean, when I resigned, I went to a seaside place. And people all over Turkey were in those areas. I mean, poor people, medium income people, or rich people. And they were, I think they were, they liked me because I was straightforward, making many decisions, very important decisions. Then most of the problems of Turkey has passed over during the first 3 years. They were happier, no coups anymore. Balance of payment improved substantially. And therefore they forced me to go into politics. Why don't you go into politics? That was the question asked by many people. When I talk on the coffee shops or on the way. And I was trying to ask them, which party you have voted before 1980? Because there were political parties before 1980. And I found out, it's very interesting, they were from different parties, not a party on the right or right of the center, but they were parties on the left. They voted. I saw there is an overwhelming majority coming up from the different sources. One difficulty I faced, I thought, there is a tradition in Turkey, political tradition, which stems from the Ottoman period. the party, basic party, which was formed at the Ottoman period, was the Unity and Progress Party. İttihat Terakki, they call it. Unity and Progress. And all parties afterwards formed out of this party. Republican People Party was formed as a continuation of Unity and Progress Party by Kemal Atatürk. And then there was right side of the party, left side of the party. Right side of the party represented by the Celal Bayar and later by Menderes, which came out of that party. They formed Democrat Party in 1945. And the Republican People Party on the left side remained with İsmet İnönü. And this was the main basic two parties formed, shaped the Turkish politics from 1945 until 1980. And either one of the parties will come to power. Democrat Party was destroyed by the military coup in 1960, but replaced by Justice Party, which was led by the Mr. Demirel, as a continuation of the Democrat Party. And I said, if I form a party, if I don't get support of the one of those leaders, which were at that time banned from the political activities by the military, I probably will not be successful, because I know the whole political way of life in Turkey. Because there was no example between 1945 to 1980, no single party came out of these two trends. They couldn't live more than 4 years. There was some trial, but they couldn't live. I think it was an exceptional case. In 1983, they did not permit the previous parties to be participate in this election. They said new parties will be permitted. The generals have the opinion a two-party system. One would be the party in power, the other will be in opposition. They thought party in the right should be party in power, and the party in the left should be the opposition, loyal opposition. And one of the retired generals was leading the party in the right. And the other party was led under secretary of their prime minister, which was on the left side. I asked to General Evren, who was the leader of the junta and also head of the state, and later became president of Turkey, elected by the vote of the approving of the constitution. I asked him, I want to form a party beside these two. And I think they saw that no danger of their makeup. Probably I would get only 10%, because all experience in the previous era showed very clearly that two-party system we live in Turkey, not the third one. They accepted it. But I couldn't get any support from the political, all political leaders. My old boss, Mr. Demirel, refused to help me. Even he said that you should not go into politics. He was banned, but he managed, engineered to form a party. But that party was not permitted to participate in the first election. And the party who was formed by the İnönü's son, Erdal İnönü, also was not permitted to participate in the first election. Only the party led by the retired general and also undersecretary of the prime minister, and my party. Contrary to many assumptions, I mean, I will only get 10% of the vote, I got 45% of the general vote in that election. It was a real election, I mean. They didn't make any fancy things during the election. And it was a shock for them, I mean. I had the majority in the parliament, single majority. And General Evren, who was the president at that time, I asked him an appointment. Because before, 2 days before the election, he made a speech against me, very much against me. Because they started to afraid I would be a shareholder in the power. But it turned out to be, I was not the shareholder, I was the power. And he accepted. I hug him and kiss him. This way, clear the ices between us. And from 84 to 87, I was prime minister. In 84, 3 months later, we changed the law. We went into local elections and permitted all the parties which were banned from participating into the election, 1983 elections, they should be in it. Although leaders like Ecevit, like Demirel, they had constitutionally 10-year ban not to be involved in the politics. But this was in the constitution, and in order to change the constitution, you need to have 2/3 majority, which we didn't have it. What happened really? We had won that election with a big majority, even though Mr. Demirel supported party, Mr. Ecevit supported party, or Mr. İnönü's parties involved in it. We were the main winner of that election. That proved that my party is going to win. And the other two parties in the parliament, which was led by general and ex-undersecretary, they were the losers. In 1987, before 1987, we went into changing the constitution. The all parties agreed we have to change the constitution, but went to referendum in order to remove the ban from the old leaders, like Demirel, Ecevit, and so on. Or there are Erbakan and Türkeş, the other two small parties. The ban was removed almost very close, 50-50%. They get a yes vote, just a small percentage increase, about 50%. Because that referendum was basically a test vote for us, whether we will control the public or we have nothing. The newcomers will take us. Because Mr. Demirel was saying the referendum was on the 6th of September 1987. These people who are in power, myself and my friends, will be out of the country on the 7th of September. But the result was not that way. I announced before the outcome of the referendum, I mean the vote cast on 6th of September, when the ballot closed, the polls closed, and started to say yes or no votes. Before that, I announced early election, 1 year early election. Election normally in 5 years, but I said right away. But not knowing the results, outcome of the referendum. And referendum came as 50-50, very close. And 2 months later, we were new election. I won that election with a big majority again. And Mr. Demirel came to parliament. Mr. İnönü was in the parliament, but they were minority parties or opposition. I had 292 deputies in the parliament. Mr. Demirel had only 67, and Mr. İnönü has something like 99. I had a very good majority. And we continued to be prime minister, second of my cabinet. And in 1989, there was election of the president. President in Turkey is 7 years duration, elected by the parliament, majority of the parliament. And for a term of 7 years, I said, I became a candidate, which they opposed me very much. I mean, they used to have, because last four presidents of Turkey were ex-army officers, starting from Gürsel, Sunay, Korutürk, and Kenan Evren. They are all either army, navy officers. This is the first time a politician became, after Celal Bayar, a civilian, I should say, became president of Turkey. That was also unusual, in a sense. We still have the discussion. I mean, opposition do not want to talk to me, but I continue with vigor the policies which we have followed. And at the same time, there are quite a big opposition in the newspapers, but I think I can manage very well. And especially this Gulf crisis, it was helped quite a lot me, because what I have estimated, it has become true. And they say my estimation was correct. And support of President Bush was also an important point in Turkey. I think what I can tell you is a very short explanation.
As you look at the area in the aftermath of the Persian Gulf War, I wonder if you would give us your assessment as to whether you believe that the time is now more opportune for settling some major problems, or has the Gulf War simply created a new set of problems that have to be dealt with?
I think both sides is true. I hope, I always say saying that wars do not solve the problem. If it solves one problem, they may create new problems. That's generally true. Here we have a problem. Problem what is going to be in Iraq. Yes, Saddam Hussein, we don't like it, but there was a stability in Iraq. Today there is no stability, and nobody knows what is going on in Iraq. Second, there was always a rift between Arabs. The Arab countries did not have the unity in or same opinion in many subjects. But this Gulf crisis made this problem between Arabs increased. And I think in the coming years we will see bigger problem in whole Arab societies. This is another area which we have to look very carefully. Now, the solution of Arab-Israeli problem, I say it's a little difficult, because PLO has some power but lost some power during this crisis. I mean credibility. Whether Arab-Israeli conflict could be solved without PLO, that's another question mark. But there is one advantage. United States has become only superpower in the world. And the Gulf crisis eradicated the Vietnam era, what you call Vietnam syndrome, and gave a big push to the United States and also President Bush. And I think if the momentum continues, they have much more to say in these difficult problems And I think role of United States now has probably increased. If they can use effectively and they have a chance to have a solution of those problems.
Can I just follow up a little bit on that? What do you believe the role of the United States with this enhanced power, and what specific things should the United States be doing in the coming months and years in order to play an effective role for dealing with those problems that you've identified?
I think United States is not going to use his power. I mean, what is established, what he can use, he has more convincing power right now. He is in a position that he can affect to the countries. There is an effective coalition of Arabs, Syria, Egypt, and Gulf countries. That's a big help, in my opinion. Provided that the United States plays fairly, Arabs plays fairly, and with the help of countries like Turkey, and maybe effects on the European is more now for the United States. And I think everybody should understand that there should not be any problem like Gulf crisis. We have overcome that difficulty, but what a cost. And if such a problem occurs, then everybody will lose it. Not on the areas, but outside of the areas. Therefore, I see there is a chance for real peace, but provided that we should not lose momentum, we will continue to press on. And the role of the United States is dominant, but not power play, I mean, with arms or so, but political.
Mr. President, let me ask you another thing, because I hope you can edit these guys out. I follow your career and also your economic policies. You seem to be always two or three steps ahead of everyone. And it seems like you have an unusual sense to sort of visualize things before they happened. And that's an instinct that very few people have. And you see where the Turkey ought to go politically. And I think that what I call your first in the public domain, your job to turn the Turkish economy into an open economy. And I think it is becoming clearly a not only viable, but a strong economy with very bright future. But I see you now that you are an emerging leader in the world scene. And it's happening automatically, your personality and all the results of what you have done so far, both politically and mostly economically in Turkey. I have a feeling that you must be, again, thinking of a world around you in Turkey, given its unique position and its heritage, both as the former empire, not as a colonial power, but they both now the historical ties to a very large group of people in the area. And also, I think there is a very large Turkey-speaking people in the vicinity of Turkey. I'd just like to see whether how you see the Turkey and your role in this new world and with all the changes happening in the Eastern Europe.
Before coming to your question, I think I should open up a little different subject about what you said. I see it far more ahead of the other people in Turkey. Yes, it may be true, but
not only in Turkey, I see that also. No, that's why I called you world leader.
The difficulty is this. Taking example of economy, I saw many, many years ago that the only solution was the market economy for Turkey. Less government intervention, much less, and leave everything to the people. This was a principle. But difficulty lies for us. People have seen the state as a father. Many, many centuries it was discussed. And how you can change those people ideas in a very short period of time. State is not your father, it's your servant, in a sense. I think we have achieved that change very substantially. New generations in Turkey coming up, they are thinking like me. Maybe some change in the old generations also. It's difficult, I know, but it is occurring. The most difficult change was in the politicians, I found out, and the newspapers, media, because they think themselves the leaders of certain things. And when you think they are, you are leaders, you don't change easily. Normally, plain people can change easily. This is one area. The other is the political arena. We have a determined political statu quo in Turkey. This was decided by İnönü much earlier. Turkey should not interfere with any affairs outside. Turkey should be kept out of the any trouble. Turkey should not take any risk and protect herself. This was the policy. And it is very simple policy. If a country managed by bureaucrats will not never take risk. Only politicians, real politicians, will take risk. I tried to change that, especially during this Gulf crisis and many other subject on the Kurdish-Turkey relations around us. But I think it is one of the most difficult change. And I want to keep a society with free ideas at the same time, to speak everything, to talk everything. But at the same time, change that society in a more democratic way. That society or that politicians, whatever it is, they should take risk in order to make gains. If you don't take risk, you don't make any gains. And I think this was an example of what we have seen in the Gulf crisis. Risk was taken, and as a reward was also taken as that risk. I always thought, if I don't take the risk, the situation will not change. It will be the same. I was going to lose the same things. But I took the risk before, and I can reap the reward. This is a policy change in Turkey. I hope that it will continue. But they call me the one-man show. That is, I think, nonsense. I mean, one-man show, when they talk about it, it is Saddam Hussein's one-man show. We have a democratic system. I have opposition, not by the parties, but also newspapers. They write everything. Today, you look to different Turkish newspapers, and they influence also outside newspapers in your country, because they take those stories from our newspapers, write it on the same basis. Typical example, my wife wanted to become a chief of the party in Istanbul. I, first of all, told it, because she asked me what your opinion. I told it, and I said, I think it's all right. It will be very dangerous for you. It will be dangerous for me at the same time. But we have to take this risk. Why? Two subjects important in Turkey. One, Istanbul was the most important place in Turkish politics. And the party should have a good showcase. A lady which is a good Democrat and relates to me at the same time, my wife, would be in Istanbul. And instead of going into a deputy supported by me, he will go from the ground root from the bottom, she will come up from the bottom. That will be an example. Second, the role of women in Turkey, which was given rights by Kemal Atatürk without any fight. But I say that we have very few deputies in the parliament, 6 out of 450. I would like to see that women more participation in political and social activity. And that was the reason I said my wife should be involved in order to make an example for the others. But this was treated as a different thing, which I am going to have a sultanate. That is impossible. I mean, my term is 7 years. How it could be? And it's a democratic society, really democratic society. There is a lot of saying against me very easily. And I took very philosophically all those what they say against me, and I tried to convince them. And I think Turkey in the last 10 years not only achieved a miracle in the economic activity, but on the political scene, if we continue. And certainly, I had a lot of load on my shoulders throughout all these 10 years. But I believe there is a new generation is coming, younger generation. Yesterday, I was in the UNC. I addressed to people, graduate school, business school. And I found of addressing to those people because I understand them very well. Same thing I understand the younger generation in Turkey because they are followers of our policies. I feel it that way.
Could I ask another?
Now, coming to that question, I'm sorry, I made this. let me tell you, Turkey will play an important role around us. I think it's a country with a pluralistic democracy and also secular state. That's a very important because religious states mostly influenced by the rules and regulations imposed by extremes in the religion. And this formula was adopted by Kemal Atatürk. I think it was a good formula. And it frees the people to have free thinking. Otherwise, you have imposed to think that way or the other way. This is a good example. Economically, we have a free market. Free market, pluralistic democracy, and the secular state is a good example of the rest of the Islamic world. Turkey plays this important role. And if you can today see, compared what was 10 years ago, you will easily say Turkey is a Western country. But we have the traditions. Yesterday, my wife visited many shops here. What she told me, I couldn't buy anything. We have everything in Turkey. Maybe cheaper products. If you could go any place in the mountains in Turkey, you will have automatic telephone, digital system. You will find your cigarettes, Marlboro, Camel, and so whatever it is, or your alcoholic beverages. It is not. It was 10 years ago. If my wife comes here, probably we will return with many luggages. Today, she could not find to buy an additional luggage. Now this change made in about 10 years. But at the same time, the change occurred in the mentality of the people. And therefore I say, not only the Islamic world, but it will be a good example for the Eastern European countries, what they have to follow. what they have to do. And we will also have an important play in the Soviet Union. There are Turkic-speaking people in the Soviet Union. Quite a big number, and increase very fast, population increase, something like 70, 80 million. And I think they all look Turkey as a good example. I have visited recently some of them. And I think we have agreed with Mr. Gorbachev, Turkey plays a stabilizing effect.
Did you talk with Mr. Gorbachev about this?
Yes, I told him. I mean, these republics should not go into the fundamentalist attitude. There is also fundamentalism coming from different sources. But they should follow the path of Turkey. Because in the future, what I say, population of Muslim population is increasing in the world. There's a 3%, close to 3% increase. In the last war, there was small danger put up. That was what they call it, jihad, which is against the Christian, war against the Christian. I think this is the most dangerous for whole world if such a thing occurs. I said Saddam Hussein will not be successful on this area. He was not. I mean, he couldn't make up the different ideas of the Islamic world. But we should not forget this is a danger in the future. And the only way, one of the way which we can handle this, I said Turkey is a Western country, and at the same time is a 98% Muslim country. And could play a role between the Western world and the Islamic world, a bridge role. And we have good influence on the rest of the Islamic world, and we have also good relation with the Western world.
President Özal, I'm wondering if you could reflect a little bit on your presidency itself. You've been a very active, strong president. And of course, that's one of the reasons why the opposition has resisted, because they've been used to something other than the kind of president you've been. Do you see your role changing the nature of the presidency in Turkey?
Let me tell you, that's very interesting. The presidents in Turkey, we have first one, Kemal Atatürk and İnönü. According to the Constitution of 1924, they should be powerless president, figurehead. They were not. They were the real powers of that time, Turkish society. But when you look at the constitution, they are figureheads. And the same constitution applied during the democratic era. Celal Bayar, who was the leader of Democratic Party, he was once the prime minister of Atatürk, but he did not become prime minister during the 1950 to 1960. He became directly to president. And Adnan Menderes, his second man, became the prime minister. But as far as I understand, the effect of the President Celal Bayar was pronounced even with the 1924 Constitution, because they were from the same group of party, I mean Democrat Party. And in many cases, Mr. Menderes get the advice of the President, although the same Constitution, which must be a figurehead. That was the reason when the army intervention took place, coup d'etat, they took also responsibility for the president. And they took him to Yasada and put on the court and gave a penalty of hanging President Bayar. He was not hanged because he was over 65. According to law in Turkey, over 65, you cannot be hanged. but Menderes was hanged. That means the tradition in Turkey until 1960, there were strong presidents, although the constitution put figureheads. 1961 constitution changed. It was also figurehead. But the, with the 1961 constitution, there came three presidents in successive with 7 years terms at that time. Gürsel, who was the leader of the coup, but he didn't know nothing about politics. He was not a political figure before. He was an army general. And then the second one elected after his death was another chief of staff, retired general, Sunay. He was not related to politics. I was amazed why Justice Party, who had the majority, will be able to select a president, but he did, they did not select the president. And they went into to armed forces to get a retired general. The third one was elected a retired admiral until we came to President Evren, who was the leader of the 12th September armed operation. They changed constitution in 1982. New constitution gave more power to president, much more, compared to 1961 constitution. It was somewhat copied from the French constitution. If you look, compare it, there are very much similarities. Only two differences, two main differences. One, in the case of French, the president is elected by the people, not by the parliament. In our case, it is elected by the parliament. That was discussed during the constitution, preparation of constitution. For example, General Evren was in the opinion of that president should be elected by the people. But his friends pushed him, we should accept the president should be elected by the parliament, because it is easy sometimes to force the parliament to elect certain president, but not the people. And the other difference is the French president is the head of the cabinet. He is preside over the cabinet. Prime Minister preside over the cabinet with the certain permission given by the president. But in reality, Prime Minister preside over the cabinet. In our case, I can preside over the cabinet whatever I want. Normally, the Prime Minister presides over the cabinet. But if I want to take, I can call the cabinet under my chairmanship, or I can go to their meeting place and preside over the cabinet. That's also possible. I think resolving of the parliament, French president resolved the parliament 1 year after the election. Not before the 1 year. In case of Turkey, there is a one condition. If a government should not get the confidence vote from the parliament, if a government cannot be formed on that condition in 45 days, or after resignation, or after new election, then I consult with the Speaker of the House and then decides on the renewing the election. This is very similar to French case, because I approve also the cabinet. I mean, I accept the ministers, whether that one or that one. I may refuse some of the ministers. I think when you look at it, compared to Constitution 1961 and 1982, there is much more power invested in the president compared to 1961. This is my point I made it. And the objection came from the opposition. They would like to see an ineffective president. They may be right in their cause, because if the president becomes ineffective, then probably the party in power will lose it, and they will make inward. And I think this discussion will continue in Turkey. I propose one thing to the parties, opposition parties. I said, in order to solve the problem, let's go to make the election of the president by the people. At the same time, 5 years duration parliamentary election. 1 week before we start the election of the president, and the second week we will select, like the French case, 2 most vote takers candidate, and another runoff election together with the parliamentary election. And I am ready to become a candidate and resign from the present position. And I offer you, you become a candidate against me. They did not accept it.
Could I pursue one other question that's very much being discussed in the United States, and that is what's going to happen in Iraq? We discussed it a little bit earlier. I know that Turkey's position has been they support the territorial integrity of Iraq. The United States supports it, so do the Syrians, so do the Iranians. One of the concerns, of course, is that Iraq might disintegrate, and Turkey has even supported autonomy for the Kurds under some kind of Iraqi control. It's up to them to decide. One of the concerns that people do have, though, is that the Kurds might at some point try to declare an independent state, and this, of course, becomes a concern to a number of people. At that stage, the Turkish opposition to that possibility, as I understand it, is based on what, the 1926 understanding that suggests that if the Kurds can't be autonomous under Iraq, that then some other jurisdiction has to occur? What's the position of the Turkish government on that particular problem?
You see, the Kurds in that area, there are 5 million Kurds in Iraq, roughly 4 million in Iran, 5 million in Iran, and 4 million in Iraq, 1 million in Syria, and roughly from that ethnic origin, 8 to 10 million in Turkey, and some 600,000 in Soviet Union. Any state, Kurdish states, will make influence all over that area. The changing of borders or carving a new state in the area is a very difficult thing to do. And I think changing, especially the borders of these states, none of those states would like to see that change of that borders. And I think we are agreed with Iranians, Iraqis, Syrians, even Soviet Union on the same base. And therefore, the best way for Kurdish people in Iraq to have their rights as the normal Iraqi citizens, whatever those, either Arabs or Turkomans or Assyrians, Kurdish, they should have their own rights as the first class citizens of Iraq composed. And this way, a kind of semi-autonomy maybe. But basically, this was given at the time of the League of Nations decision in the area. But what has happened during the years of 1970, 75 and 80, we have found that Kurds made a lot of problems with the Iraqi government, and they were pressurized by the Iraqis. They were killed by the Iraqi army by thousands, and even put under this chemical gas attack. In the previous years, Turkish policy was mainly not to relate too much with this activity. We have Kurdish people in Turkey ethnically, but they are not different than Turkish people. We see them not as a minority. Some people claim that we should see them as a minority. No, it's an integral part of the society. It's very simple to explain that Turkish people and the Kurdish people, basically in Turkey, we are Sunnis. We have no religion differences. And I see it, most of the important thing is the religion differences, same as seen in the Northern Ireland. And second, we have lived together. Together, it is not only one part of Turkey, but it's mixed in all over Turkey. There are Kurds, origin people, has come to the Western Anatolia and stayed there, become rich. There are ministers, deputies, judges, generals, and there is no difference among in this society. The only difference there was in starting 1984, there was a small Kurdish Workers' Party, which is a communist-led, supported by a Syrian at that time, and they made an uprising in the southeast Anatolia, small guerrilla force, but they are well under control right now. And I think we have put that fire compared what has been during 1984, 85, 86. And with the change of policy of Turkey, looking to the Kurdish people, take example of 1988. After the Iraqi chemical attack on those Kurds, Iraqi Kurds, we have accepted fleeing Kurds to Turkey. In the previous era, we would not accept that. 60,000 people came to Turkey, took refuge in Turkey. Still, we have 30,000, and we are supporting humanitarian support we are giving them. And once the Iraqi problem is solved, probably they will return their homeland. Now, on the other hand, I advise to my government, and I said, talk to the Kurdish people in Iraq and what their aim, what they want to do. And I told them very clearly, I mean, we have instructed to tell them that we are not against their humanitarian concerns or the better life for Kurdish people in Iraq, but we are against, you should know, that any state which you will make in the area, then everybody in the area will be disturbed, and then it will make a big problem. This is the point we made, and I think it's well accepted. And I think the Iraqi Kurdish people would like to see that they live peacefully in their area with the rights equal to those of Arabs.
So how strong is the support for your motherland party among the Turkish, among the Kurdish population of Turkey?
I do not know, but that will be a test in the coming up election, 1992. But we have seen that during the some by-election, which has happened in that area, we have won it. I think this change of policy also indicated it's good for the country. But I say one thing, the change of policy is not very easy, especially with this statu quo holders. This is a very important change of the policy.
I think we have time for one more question, and I'd like to pose it this way. I think you've taken some extraordinarily constructive steps, for example, in talking to the Kurdish opposition in Iraq, recommending a lifting on the ban of speaking Kurdish in Turkey, which has existed for most of this last decade. As you know, there have been some allegations, particularly in the European Parliament, about Turkish human rights policies. We have that problem in this country. If you've watched TV lately and seen our Los Angeles police striking people, it happens everywhere. I'm wondering if you could comment on the legitimacy of those allegations and what your government has done to address the problem.
I think you have seen probably the Amnesty International the booklets or paper. I have seen same thing in Washington Post also. And every time I come here to the United States, they publish something. And first of all, for torture, we have signed two important conventions, which was not the case before. I mean, before 1980, there was nothing signed against this torture in Turkey. This was one European convention, Council of Europe Convention of Torture, against torture. The second is the United Nations Convention against torture. That means we have left to those convention, and they can come and study and make certain checks and advise our government, you do this thing wrong or that thing wrong. And also we have been a member of the European Council of Court of Human Rights. We have been signed that agreement. Anybody in Turkey may go to that court. This was the exception of cases, which will be followed by different modalities. Second, Turkey, as I said, is a country with a multi-party system, democratic, and there is a free press. Misunderstanding occurs, I believe, which we are going to correct it, whether the ideas will be put under the trials or whether the terrorism, act of terrorism, will be put under trials. I think in our penal code, there are mixed articles. And there is a new trend now I am trying to formulate. Take those articles related to the terrorism or supporting terrorism, put in a new law, act of terrorism, and abolish the articles related to the ideas, expression, make it new. This is now going to be done in a few months in Turkey. This way, we will get this misunderstanding, because they always misunderstand whether this is a terrorism or an opinion of people. Now, opinion, which is not going to be an act of terrorism, will not be penalized. That's completely changed. And this was in the previous era. Communism was prohibited in Turkey. The religious parties prohibited in Turkey. And different opinions, which is against the state, which was prohibited in Turkey. I think we will only keep one point, which is the separation of the Turkish Republic, separation of certain part of the Turkish Republic, elimination. And eventually, it should be removed also as the time goes on, when Turkish Republic becomes richer and better. And I think this is the point I want to make in this area. The rest of the thing relates more of historical nature. I mean, during the era of military occupation, which they have judged maybe 100,000, 200,000 people. There is always in every country police brutality, which is not systematic, I can say, because in case of police brutality, if there is a case, it will go to courts, and there has been many police officers have been jailed, and they have getting penal courts.
President Özal, on behalf of Duke University, thank you very much.
Thank you.